Good morning. Morning.
No more outside. Now in your grace.
Before the throne. It's where we come to offer praise.
Good morning. Give me one moment here. Good morning, Miss Aretha Joe. What's up? Good morning to everyone. My laptop is trying to freeze up on me. I'm having some technical difficulties right now. But we're going to get through this. And if I have to shut this down, then my PowerPoint is going to be toasted. But come on in. Nevertheless, you know that we're going to move forward regardless. Okay? Just give me one moment here. Let's see. Hey, Sean. Please tell me. Please tell me that I didn't. I'm booting back up, but you all stay. You stay tuned with me because we got some good stuff to share this morning about recovering. I have been up preparing, and I'm excited to deliver this. And so just stay with me, and we're gonna dive in. You all can go ahead and turn to Psalm 107 while my computer is coming up. Okay, we're going to open back up where we left off. And prayerfully, everything is still there. If I see that PowerPoint, yes, it's there, and I'm excited. Thank you, Lord. All right, we can move in. I wanted to continue to play my song, but hey, thank you all for your patience. Thank you for working with me. Turn to Psalm 107, verses 19 and 20, and we'll start right there. Man, the devil tried it. But God came through. Psalm 107, 19 and 20. And I want to talk about, speak from this subject. We shall recover. We shall recover. We shall recover. I was kind of tossing and turning last night. And every time I tossed and turned, I kept hearing the word recover, recover, recover. That's just been a word that's been on my heart for the past couple of weeks. I keep hearing recover, recover. And it's a good word to deliver to the people. It's a good word to receive because I believe that a lot of things that we've lost, that God is going to put us in a position to recover a lot of things. So Psalm 107 says this, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble and he delivered them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. I'm going to read that again. Listen, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them. And so, listen, that goes to show how important it is to be receptive to the word of God, because God will send his word to you and his word will take root in your life and change you totally. And he delivered them from their destruction. Okay, let's go ahead and once again, I welcome all of you who are chiming in, who tuned in this morning. You are not here by accident. You are here by God's divine providence, meaning that God ordained that you will be here today because he has something to say to you. I promise you that. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day, for this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for waking us up and clothing us in our right minds. We thank you, God, for being our healer. We thank you for being our deliverer. We thank you, God, for providing everything we need according to your riches and glory. We thank you, God, for walking with us through our pain, for being our, for providing all we need according to your riches and glory. We thank you for lifting us up, God. We thank you for pouring into us. We thank you for your word, which is living and active. We thank you, God, for sending us the rhema that we need, God, to meet us where we are. We thank you that we are still changing. We are still evolving. We are still developing and becoming the people that you've called us to be. We come this morning asking for forgiveness of sin because we know that somewhere down the line, we've missed the mark. We've come short of the glory of God. Your word says that if we confess our sins, that you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We celebrate your faithfulness today, God. We thank you, God, that even when we are unfaithful, the Bible says that you remain faithful, God. So we give you all the glory. We give you the honor. We give you the praise that you alone are worthy of. We thank you for walking us right into our purpose, God, and providing everything that we need to accomplish what you set us in this earth to accomplish. We know that no weapon formed against us is going to prosper and that we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus our Lord. We receive your word today. We receive our healing. We receive your blessings and we receive our restoration. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and thank you. Amen. Good morning. We're going to start out this morning. we see that the word of God tells us from the introduction that those who cry out to the Lord in their trouble, he delivers them from their distress. So that's where I get my word recovery from this morning. And I'm going to break this down. I'm going to make it very plain and clear to all of you who are listening. What does it mean to recover? I'm going to give you some simple definitions, but they're going to make the whole message make sense. One, to recover means to get back or to gain or regain something lost or taken away. Oh, man, we own this morning. To recover means to get back or regain something lost or something taken away. Secondly, it means to make up or make good from something that is lost or damaged. To make good something that was once lost or damaged. And I know that listening this morning, I'm not the only person who's ever lost something. I'm not the only person who's ever been damaged. I'm not the only person this morning that has something taken away from them. All of us need to hear this message on recovery, because a lot of us are still trying to bounce back from things that happened years ago, you know. But I need you to know that God is in the business of restoring and helping you to recover. The third definition for recover means to regain strength, to regain composure, to gain balance, or the like. Okay, it means to regain strength, it means to regain composure, or it means to regain balance. And we know the past couple of years, a lot of us have been off balance. A lot of us have lost strength, and a lot of us have not contained or kept our composure straight, okay? So all of the things that we've lost, God is on a mission to help us to recover that. The fourth definition, which is my last definition, it means to seek God for restoration. To seek God for restoration through crying out. To seek God for restoration through crying out to God. As Psalm 107 says, when they cried out to God, he delivered them from their distress. Distress is another word for trouble. Distress is another word for hard times, you know, difficult moments. The Bible says that when you're in these moments, you don't need to wait until they pass before you call out to God. The scripture says that they called out to him in their trouble, and then God delivered them from their distress. So a lot of times you have to understand that when you're going through these tough times, those are the best times to get in touch with God. Not when it passes, not after it's all over, not when the storm has cleared. You need to reach out to him in your trouble, because the scripture says that he is a very present help in time of trouble. Okay, so what, now this is where it's going to get a little bit more deep. What does your recovery entail? A lot of people want to recover, but many people aren't willing to do what is necessary to regain their recovery. You know, recovery is not always an easy thing. Many of us have recovered from a lot of things, and all of us have been an ex something. But people struggle when it comes to recovery. Look at all the people who are on drugs, or people who may be labeled alcoholics, or people who may be dealing with a slew of other things. It's always difficult to recover, because recovery entails process. I need somebody to type in process. Recovery entails process. If you're ever going to bounce back, you cannot abort or abandon the process. It's important that you stick to the process, and the process entails a lot of different things. Okay, so what does your recovery entail? One, your recovery will take time. Your recovery will take time. So many of us wish we could bounce back overnight. Unfortunately, it does not work that way. When you have had things taken away from you, it takes time to build that back up. When you have been broken, when you have gone through a process of being eliminated, I mean, it takes time to bounce back from the perils of life. And many of us, we wish we could just bounce back, just step back into the swing of things, but unfortunately, it just doesn't work that way. Recovery takes time. As a matter of fact, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 3 says this. It says, there is a time to kill and a time to heal. Now, here it is. Okay, we see that there are two different time periods here. There's a time when death happens, and there's also a time to recover from it. Okay, so, but listen, it is your responsibility to discern when you've had enough of the killing. Okay, there have been a lot of things killed in you. And if you continue to allow people to come in and to kill your pride, to kill your emotion, to kill your heart, to kill all these things in you that God wants to use to be a blessing to the kingdom, you know, at some point you have to get to a point where you say, I'm done with allowing people to take from me. Okay? So, it's your responsibility to put an end to that. Because you can never recover if you're always in the killing stage or being killed stage, okay? You have to overcome that, and then you have to start embracing your season of healing, okay? And healing takes time. If you fall and scrape your leg or your arm today, it's not going to be healed tomorrow. It has to grow a scab. You know, it has to heal. It takes time. And so no matter what you've been through, bounce back doesn't happen overnight, you know. And so the most important part about this healing process is that you don't need to abandon it. You don't need to abandon it. But it's your responsibility to have that aha moment where you say, you know what, I'm not putting up with that anymore. I'm not going to let people kill the best parts of me. I'm not going to give that to people. I'm not going to let people take advantage of me. No longer am I going to put up with that. And once you put an end to that, then the healing process begins. But this is where a lot of people go wrong. They continue to allow people to kill them and think that they're healing at the same time. No, you cannot choose both of them. You have to choose one or the other. It's either you're going to let people continue to slaughter you and to take you down through there, or you're going to say, hold up. I'm tripping. You know what? I'm allowing myself to be treated this way or to go through this. You have to put an end to that, because as long as you allow it, it will continue. So this is your season to embrace your healing. Listen to this right here. I want you to look with me in John chapter 5, verse 6. There's a man in that passage of scripture who had been sick for 38 years. Can you imagine being sick for 38 long years? This man was sick for 38 long years. And Jesus asked him a question in verse 6. He said, when Jesus saw him lying there, this is a man who is lying in his condition for 38 years, watching other people be healed. And he's just lying there waiting on someone to put him in a position to be healed when he didn't even understand you was already in a position to be healed. It was your lack of willingness to move forward that prohibited you from being healed. Okay, so here it is. And Jesus saw him lying there and knew he had already been in his condition for a very long time. Watch this. He said to him, do you wish to get well? Do you wish to get well? Now, to me, it's kind of like a rhetorical question to ask somebody who's been sick for 38 years, do you want to get well? Let me just keep it frank. It sounds like a dumb question to ask somebody. That would be like me going up to Erlanger, going to a room where a patient has been in there for years and ask them, do you want to get out of here? I mean, the obvious answer would be yes, but really, hold on. Jesus asked that question for a reason. And I'm going to give you the reasons I believe that Jesus asked that question. One, you cannot expect that everyone with an illness wants to recover. Lord have mercy. Everybody does not have the mindset that I'm coming out of this. Everybody does not want to get well. Let me tell you why. Some people don't want to be healed or made whole because they use their pain to gain attention and not grow. Have you ever met somebody who is something like a hypochondriac? A person, every time you turn around, something is broken, something is hurting, something is wrong, it's never a good day with them. You know, I guess the clinical definition or name would be hypochondriac. And a person who is a hypochondriac is a person who in their mind, there's nothing physically wrong with them, but in their mind, they make themselves believe that there is something wrong with them. And so they start claiming stuff that ain't there. And I believe that a lot of people do this not because pain should help you grow. When you've been through enough hell and pain in your life, at some point, it helps you to grow so you won't have to go through the same pain again. But some people don't use their pain to grow. They use their pain for attention. And that's not a good thing. You know, some people are bent on attention and they'll do just about anything to get it. A third reason is that people want to be healed, but many don't want to be stretched. Don't you know that if you go outside right now and you tear a ligament, or you break a finger or something, if you go to the doctor and they bandage it up and take the bandages off at some point, they're going to have you doing certain stretches that's going to get your body back to normalcy, okay? They're going to stretch it. You can't just go out and just start using something that was broke 2 or 3 weeks ago. You're going to have to work your way back into it. You understand what I'm saying? It's part of the recovery process. And so some people want to be healed and they want to be made whole, but God tells us, in order for me to make you whole and in order for me to heal you, I'm going to have to stretch you. You know, it's just like going into the gym and think you're going to throw 405 up without stretching. No, stretching helps you get stronger and get to the next phase in your life. So God will use certain things in your life to help you to recover and stretch you and get you back to normalcy. 4, some people settle into a place of comfortability. Jesus asked this man, do you want to get well? Why did he ask him that? Because the man might have been comfortable being in his predicament. Some people are more comfortable than you think. You're feeling sorry for them, but really they're comfortable. And as long as a person finds comfort in something, and I looked up the definition for comfort, and it means the lack of pain, you know, the dismissal of pain, you know, they're not being stretched. I mean, that's why they're comfortable, because there's no pain in comfort. You know, so sometimes that's why God does allow pain to hit us, to run us out of places where we become too comfortable. But Jesus asked this man, do you want to get well? Meaning that there was a possibility that he had embraced the mindset that if it happens, it does. And if it doesn't, then it just doesn't happen. And that is not the mindset that you want to have. In many cases, people's lack of desire to be whole can block them from being healed. Okay? People's lack of desire to be made whole will get in the way of them from even being healed. When Jesus heals people in the Bible, not only does he heal them spiritually, but he typically heals them physically. He makes them whole. But a lot of people want to be made whole, don't want to be made whole. They just want to be healed, and it gets in the way of the whole process. Okay, so let's talk about something else. What does recovery entail? Okay, write this down. Your recovery entails adjusting your expectations. Your recovery entails you adjusting your expectations of others. I believe that many people go into deep depressions because they have or put unrealistic expectations on other people. They put unrealistic expectations on other people. To adjust your expectations of others actually frees you from unnecessary frustration. Watch this. That means that you have to let people be true to their nature. Do you hear me? You have to allow people to be who they are. The reason you're so frustrated is because you want them to change for you. You have an idea of what you want them to be and what you want them to become. And when they don't become that, it frustrates you. And so you come up with this plan and the scheme to do all these things for this individual or to this individual because you think that when you do these things that they're going to change. And I need you to understand that a person will always be true to their nature unless Christ changes their nature. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, all things are new. Okay, watch this. You gotta stop trying to get people or change people to fit your life, causing them to live a lie. When you try to make people change to fit you, you are forcing them to live a lie. Oh my goodness. Look at Jeremiah 13:23. Jeremiah 13:23 says this. Can an Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard his spots? That's a question. And you know what the answer to it is? No. A leopard cannot change his spots, and an Ethiopian cannot change his skin. And so, in essence, what Jeremiah is saying is that you have to let people be who they are. Why? Because that's what they're going to be anyway. And all this frustration that we've dealt with, trying to change people, trying to do all these things, being frustrated, losing our minds, just letting ourselves go, you know, enough is enough. You got to just let people be who they are. I was thinking earlier, I was like, you know what? Everybody don't like dogs. Everybody don't like dogs. But just because you don't like dogs doesn't mean that you can take the bark from the dog. They bark too much. Oh my God, I wish I could just take the bark from the dog. That would be cruel to the dog because it's in the dog's nature to bark, right? Okay. And so it would be crazy for you or me to lose our mind trying to remove a dog's bark box, trying to remove that, because by nature, that's what it does. However, I was thinking there are a few things that you can do. Since you cannot take the bark from the dog, what you can do is that you can remove the dog and his whole nature. In other words, you can either move away from the dog or have the dog to be removed away from you. Relocate, but you cannot change the nature of the dog. Wherever the dog goes, the nature of it goes with it. So what I'm saying to you is that you can't change people. You can't change people. A lot of you are on here this morning and you're probably semi-depressed because people won't become what you want them to be. How frustrating is that? So we have to, when it comes to recovery, let me go back to you. It, once again, it recovers. Recovery means that it takes time. In recovery, it means that it will take time, okay? And it's your responsibility to know when you've had enough, because God wants you to recover. This is your moment. This is your season to recover from everything that you've lost. I was thinking of the prodigal son. When he left home with everything that he needed. Once he got to his destinations, he was misused. People befriended him. He spent his livelihood with carousing and wild living, according to the scriptures. And while he was out there in what the Bible calls a far, far country, he went bankrupt. I mean, when he went bankrupt, there were no friends to be found. There was nobody rocking with him. I mean, everybody just scattered, because guess what? He had no more money. He blowed his inheritance. And the Bible says that one day he realized that he was living beneath what he was supposed to live. His father was a wealthy man, a king. He was a son of a king, but he was out here living like he had no family. And the Bible says that the man came to his senses and the man went home. And when he went home, his father restored everything that he lost. That's what recovery looks like. You know, sometimes you have to realize that I have moved too far away from the place that God had placed me to have the lavish life. I have moved so far away from where God really placed me to be cared for. And once you realize that you have moved away from the covering and the blessings that God has placed in your midst, you have to just swallow your pride. The scripture says that pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. You have to realize that, man, I did something wrong. And if you realize that you've done something wrong, and just like that prodigal son went home and his father restored him, God wants to do the same thing for you. I wish I could share this message with the world. No matter how far off you've been, no matter what you've done, no matter how off you've been, God has room at the cross for you. That's, if I could share one last word, I would tell people, get to the cross. because this is where your life will change. Once you get to the cross of Jesus and you realize that he paved the way, he paid the price so that you could experience recovery. But there are some things that you have to deal with within yourself, even before you get to the point of recovery. You have to deal with your pride. You have to deal with sin. You have to deal with your old nature that tries to arise and take over your life and tries to trump the new you. You know, you have to deal with all of that stuff. And in order to do that, that means you have to humbly go before God. The scripture says that humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due season. You know, so like, don't let pride destroy you. Everybody struggles. You know, it's not foreign to struggle. You're not the only one that's going through something. You're not the only one who may be dealing with financial problems. You're not the only one that's struggling in relationships. You're not the only one who might not like where you are in life right now. You're not the only one who's going through these things. Sometimes the enemy tries to make us think that we're the only ones going through this. And if you start thinking that you're the only ones going through this, then now you think God is picking on you. You know, when actually God wants to develop you. God wants you to recover. He wants you to be restored. And he wants you to accomplish what he's placed you in this earth to accomplish. So going back to the text in the beginning, he says they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from all their distress. If you want to be delivered from your distress, then the first thing you must do is acknowledge that there is distress there. And once you acknowledge that there is trouble, there is distress, you know, there is a strain in something, then the next thing you do is you take it to God. You call out to him, and don't be fake with God. You can be transparent with him, and you can be real with God. People kill me thinking that when you approach God with all these sweet little prayers, now that I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep, dear Heavenly Father. Real prayer don't always work like that. Sometimes your life can be so tore up that when you go to God, you truly cry out to him for real. And you say what's on your heart. You say what's on your mind. You tell him exactly how you feel. That's the type of relationship that you're supposed to have with God. Not coming to him with these fake prayers, knowing that you feel like screaming, hollering, shouting. You feel like doing all of that. And God says, I welcome that. There is nothing you can do that can change my nature. I'm God. And so it doesn't matter if you get frustrated. It doesn't matter if you question something that has happened in your life. It doesn't matter if you question something that happened to someone you love. When you come to me and pour your heart out to me, cry out to me, I'm still going to be God at the end of it. You know, so when they cried out to him, he delivered them from all of their troubles and delivered them from their distress. And in closing, he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. And so when you're going through, you must always be attentive to the word. Don't abandon the word. I know a lot of church facilities are not open. That is no excuse for not getting the word. Many of us have been in church for 10 years plus. And if you have been in church for 10 years plus, you should not be struggling spiritually just because church doors are not open. You know, you got used to a form of religion. You know, you should still be cracking your word open. You should still be praying. And if you were shouting in the church building, you should still be shouting in your house, you know, wherever you are. You know, if you have a relationship with God, I need you to understand that it transcends four walls. You know, wherever you are, the Lord should be there with you. Okay? He promised to never leave you. He promised never to forsake you. In closing, I want to say this. You will recover. I don't know what you've been through or what you're going through, but troubles don't last always. Weeping may endure for a night, but the Bible teaches us that joy comes in the morning. Troubles don't last always. Whatever you're in right now, you won't even remember it years from now. What you're going through financially, there's going to come a time where you won't be struggling financially. You're going to have overflow. And when you're dealing with overflow, that means that you have, God has blessed you in such a way that the blessings on your life begins to run off onto people who are connected to you. That's the season that many of us are getting ready to walk into. You know, you have to be faithful to God, be faithful to his word, be faithful to what he's called you to, and then trust him to put everything else in perspective for you, okay? Like, whatever you're going through right now, I just need you to hold on to this for the rest of the month. This too shall pass. Those people that you feuding with, that you beefing with, this too shall pass. Some of the people that you're beefing with right now, those relationships will recover. Sometimes we just struggle with disagreements. You know, we disagree with each other and then we write the whole relationship off. But I believe that God, that everything is coming full circle and God is allowing relationships that were meant to be to recover. They're recovering. They're being restored back to their rightful places. Everybody have misunderstandings. But guess what? We've been guilty of mismanaging misunderstandings. Okay, but when we go back to God and he allows us to think this stuff through, then he says that was petty. That was petty. It was senseless. And a good relationship could have been ruined if I would have let it. But since I'm a God of restoration, I'm just going to allow a little time to pass so that everybody can recoup, so that everybody can check their own pride, so everybody can check their own hearts. And I'm going to bring you all back together and you're going to work through this. And then guess what? Everything else will be happily ever after. Okay? So you, me, all of us are in the process of recovery. When somebody calls you later and be like, what you up to? I'm up to recovery. I'm recovering. Everything that was taken from me, everything that was lost, I'm getting it back. This is my season to do that. That's my focus. That's my motto. I'm standing on it. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for allowing us to recover. We thank you, God, that everything that we've lost, you allowed us to maneuver through those things. Some things you allowed us to keep, some things you allowed to part for reasons. God, we thank you for being faithful. We thank you for never abandoning us, for always being faithful to be there, to provide, to lead and guide us, Lord, through seasons of misunderstandings. God, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise for just being Jehovah Jireh, for being who you are, God. You are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, God, who guides us and leads us into all truth. And we thank you that the truth makes us free. We pray for your people this morning, God, who tuned in, that you would do something amazing and miraculous in their lives today, God, that you would help them to navigate to that place of recovery, to not be like that man who had been sick for 38 years, sitting in his condition and having to be asked, does he want to get well? Father, we want to get well. We want to do better. We want to become better stewards of the things you've given us. We want to become better servants to you and to your kingdom. Forgive us, Lord, for what we have not done. Forgive us for what we have not accomplished. Forgive us, Lord, for getting to a place of comfortability and allowing it to affect our kingdom assignments, Lord. We ask that you would just restore everything that was lost, that you would get all the glory from it, and we'll be careful to give you all the praise. We ask this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. Praise God, man. Recovery zone is right. We are recovering. We are all recovering from something. And I'm excited. I'm excited because once you recover, man, recovery takes you down a different route, a different road in life. And, you learn from it. You learn from everything that you've experienced. And I'm gonna say this now, get out of here. Everything that you have been through should operate as a stepping stone to where you're going. All the heartaches, all the pains, all the failed relationships, everything that you've been through, all the pain, all the misery, all the sleepless nights, all the tears, everything that you've been through, God is setting you up for elevation. The strength that you're going to have, you would not have obtained it if you had not been through the struggle. The good news is this: he didn't allow it to kill you. He didn't allow it to kill you. And so I pray that God continues to bless you and that he keeps you. Those of you who believe in sowing, you can do that by, you can cash app Inner Peace Church. You can text give to 423-301-5545, or you can go to our website, which is www.innerpeacechurch.org, and you can give online. And I also want to say, if you're on here and you don't know Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, we always want to draw the net. We want to give you the opportunity to give your life to Christ. Jesus came to save. The Bible says in Luke 19:10 that the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. And whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. God is trying to save people, because whether you understand the times or not, people are dying. People are getting up out of here. And a lot of people are dying without Christ. I've done so many funerals and homegoings. It's just, I think it's really sad how preachers make it seem like, we can't put anybody in heaven or hell, but I just got to be honest. Everybody ain't going up yonder. Everybody ain't going to be with the Lord. You know, it's just not the reality of it all. You know, so we just need to make sure that our hearts are right with God. And having a heart that is right with God doesn't mean that you're going to be perfect. You're never going to be perfect on this side. Hate to bust your bubble. You know, I know you may have grown up in church where they expect perfection from you. Yeah, you strive for it, but I just need you to understand that when you don't hit the target and when you fail, you got to get back up and try again, you know, but keep pushing. But anyway, I'm Pastor King. I love you all, and I will talk to you all soon. May God keep you, and may he bless you richly.